Hello, everybody. Thank you very much for coming. Thank you, immigrants. Warm welcome to How Hebel Amufa, to Berlinale Talents. And we think you cannot have enough courage, so we just go on for the entire week being very courageous and also hopefully making you and encourage you with what is happening here on stage. There has been beautiful premiere yesterday night, and I'm very, very happy to have the director here today with me. But first and foremost, please let me introduce you to Ben Gibson, our moderator. Ben. Great to have you back. Have a nice day.
Thank you very much. So I think I can guarantee that we're going to get a bit of courage against all odds tonight. What I want to say first about Gurinder Chadha, I'll say when she's actually here. Could you please give a warm welcome to Gurinder Chadha, the director of the Viceroy's House. I think the first thing I want to say, and in a minute we're going to look at a bit of the Viceroy's House and talk about that, and then we're going to go back in history and look at your career a bit. But if you start at the end of the 80s and you're a Punjabi Sikh who's come from Kenya and you're living in South London and you're making films about social inclusion, post-colonialism, identity, the visibility of the Asian diaspora in Europe and in the UK about arranged marriages, I guess most of you are going to conclude that this is a very important activity, but there's not going to be a massive audience for it. It's just going to influence other people because these are social ideas. But then you haven't met Gurinder Chadha, because Gurinder Chadha is not willing to talk about these things unless she finds a way to get a massive audience who are going to really respond to that in a huge and general way, in, or through whatever techniques of storytelling she can develop. That's my theory of Gurinder Chadha. Can we just talk about this film? This is the biggest film that you've made by a long way, because you're making a historical drama. Yeah. And it's 6 or 7 years in the making and preparation. Yes. What I'm curious about, because here we have what might be otherwise a television sort of mini-series where we're going to meet the Mountbattens in their home and see their silver, and we're going to have meals with them and all that kind of thing in the 40s in Delhi. And in the meantime, we have real quotes, real characters, people who are working downstairs. So this upstairs and downstairs, and you're matching two in a way completely different narratives. I'm just trying to imagine you sitting in somebody's office and explaining why they should finance such such a proposition. Could you say something about, could you take us back to that office and give us the first two sentences of your appeal?
Yeah, I've said that I wanted to make a film about the ordinary people being affected by partition, but also the politics of what was behind the reason for partition. And I wanted to tell that story through upstairs, downstairs. But it was pre-Downton Abbey when I had that talk. Yeah. So it was a very British conceit, the upstairs, downstairs. And the original program, upstairs, downstairs, was very political, if you remember. Yeah. And the downstairs characters were as important as the upstairs. So for me, this was a way that I could tell ordinary people's stories. These are the people who, the servants who might normally be extras in these big Raj movies, but at the same time satisfy the financiers and tell, you know, the upstairs story. But in the end, I think that although the film is upstairs, downstairs, I think it blends very well, actually. And I think you sometimes forget when you're upstairs and downstairs, because everybody's caught up in the same political drama.
Let's have a very quick clip, so that some people in this audience have seen this movie. Can you give me, show me? Yeah, quite a few. Great. Yeah, yes. Yeah. Great. So that's going to be useful and important when we get into detail. Just a few of you. So we're going to have a quick clip which probably sets all this out, and the very British Edwardian Raji activities going on the lawn is what I think we'll see. we have the first clip? Developing over time, because you've worked with kind of Jane Austen stories and films which are kind of essentially family social comedies, which are also about very important political issues. Where in your experience of thinking about cinema and thinking about storytelling do you think that comes from, that wish to take on some very powerful and important message and take all of the extra weight out of it so that you can make it personal and everyday?
Well, I think that it was important to me, if I had the opportunity to tell stories, was to tell stories about people like myself and put people like myself in the center of the frame and tell the story from that particular point of view. That particular view is interesting because I have a foot, you know, in Europe. I have a foot in India. I'm both British and I'm both Punjabi. And having this duality, you know, allows me to see things from many different perspectives. Also, you know, being on the left and being a feminist also in the same way allows us to see the world differently from people who are on the right. So it's the same thing, you know, politically, wherever you're aligned, you see the world from that perspective. If you just extend that consciousness to suddenly being bilingual or being Indian as well as English, you then start seeing how you can start looking at realities in a different way. And I think that the question of hybridity is important because when I first started, you know, I didn't really know I was going to be a filmmaker. I mean, I was a news reporter, and I thought that I was basically going to work in the newsroom. And it was really through working with you that I got to make my first film, that somebody then saw it at Channel 4, it's Karen Bamborough, and said, oh, this is a voice we need to encourage. And so really, I mean, I made the film, I was like, oh, wow, you know, never been to film school, but said what I wanted to say about myself and putting that point of view, the British Indian point of view, forward in a way that it hadn't been done before. But then I was really encouraged by other people who wanted to develop that voice. But I also think that it was a big plus in many ways for me that I didn't go to film school. I studied development studies at university. That's sort of in that at that time, third world was India. That's quite ironic now.
Those are the days.
Those are the days. In fact, I was a very bad student at UEA because I did not study very much. I used to go to all the parties, and I used to fight with my lecturers because they used to lecture us on poor people in Tamil Nadu in South India trying to, you know, grow crops out of really bad soil and things like that. And I would say, but I know Indian people who are rich, you know, why do you keep showing me people who are poor, you know, what is going on here? And this is before even media studies, but I would always get very upset because I'd say, you always depress me with poor stories about India and development when I know rich people in India and life's not like this. So I would get into fights with my lecturers and then, you know, and then go off. But anyway, I did do development studies and then I did journalism, and I thought that I did want to get behind a camera. I did want to tell our stories, and I thought the best way to do that was through the newsroom.
Yeah. Great, thank you. I mean, I took a vow not to mention my role in the commissioning of your first film, so now you've mentioned it, I can too.
Yeah. All because of Ben.
So We're going to see a little bit of I'm British But, which is the film that we made together. And one thing I remember from it is you saying, come on, when is this to be ready? We've got to get it out on television very quickly, because you had this kind of media, BBC reporter approach. And I kept saying, look, Gurinder, it's a film. It's just got to be really interesting and chilled out, and it'll play in festivals in 6 months from now, and you've got to really relax about this thing of having an audience. And you always said, yeah, but when are we going to do a publicity shot where I'm dressed up with a British bulldog and all of that? So you had this idea already, like, you know, there's no point in doing it unless everybody knows we've done it.
And I think that also came from, at that time in Britain, of course, there were very few filmmakers of colour, and there had been this move to encourage that, and so we had some workshops for black filmmakers. There was Sankofa, there was Black Audio News Collective, there was Retake, Chedo, and these were all funded workshops for people of colour to explore ideas. And I wasn't part of any of those workshops, but some of the films that were made to me were very experimental and very art house. And whilst they were absolutely important for that time and for that debate, and one can go back now, and I mean, I can look back at Looking for Langston and Hanswer Songs, and I mean, these are seminal films, you know. Who Shot Colin Roach, you know. But for me, I decided at that point that if I was going to make films, I wanted to make films that the people who were in them would be able to enjoy them and understand them. So it wasn't that I was going to be sort of anti-academic as such. I wanted to be populist and commercial, because for me there was no point spending all that time working on a film if lots and lots of people weren't going to go and see it, and or if it was only going to be discussed by academics or film students. And that's not to denigrate people who do that. I think that's an important thing.
It was very important.
But I think for me at that time, you know, and don't forget, I came from a tradition where, you know, my parents had loved Indian films, popular Indian cinema. So, you know, I grew up in Southall. I used to go to the Indian cinemas in Southall. So for me, film was a family event. Families enjoyed films, not just academics.
All right.
So that became where I decided if I was going to make films, I had to aim for as many people in the world as possible to watch the films.
Great. So we're going to see a little bit of I'm British, but before you see the clip, I just want to say, I mean, this is quite an extraordinary film at the time, and I guess we're going to spend a bit of time talking about Britain and British identity and or the collapse of Britain or whatever British subject we discuss. And at that time, seeing a film where there were people with strong regional accents who were Asians or people who worked on farms who were Muslims, and it was all absolutely outlandish in the UK. So you've got to think about this film coming onto your television screen in 1990 in the UK, which is a country full of people who imagine that the UK is like an old Alan Parker film with lots of white people riding around on a bicycle with some bread. And then you see the context of what Gurinder is trying to do. So could we have the second clip, please? Thanks. I should probably say on Gurinder's behalf that it's not her fault that the British Film Institute at that time was making films on incredibly tiny budgets very quickly on 16mm, and they would send filmmakers around Britain to make surveys of the country with a Super 8 camera so that they could have the inserts of people sitting with their family. It's not at all her fault. Yeah, it's actually still really vibrant and really interesting. I still love to see sheep and horses with conversations about Muslim faith.
You know, amazingly, I show there's a young artist in Toronto, young man in Toronto, Sikh, whose brother is actually very He's a YouTuber. He's very famous. His name's Just Rain. The Indians might know him. He's very popular in Canada. But his brother is an artist, and he contacted me and said, your film has been so important for me growing up in Canada, and do you mind, could I have permission to quote it in my thesis at art school? And I was like, yeah, sure, you know. And so he did. And then the kid got a placement in London at the Slade. So he came to London and he spent a day with me, following me around, and I took him to some of the locations for the film. And he stood there going, oh my God, like this film. And
you took him to that fruit shop where you did the Bhangra dancing?
Yes, to South of Broadway and to the gas towers and everywhere. And he took pictures, and then now he's just told me that he's done a whole collection of work on my short and the other short, actually. And he's actually taken stills that are important for him from the film, and he's painted them, and he's added his own commentary on them. And so it's sort of come alive a whole generation later with this Sikh artist in Canada. So, I mean, that to me is the power of art.
And that's great, yeah.
And when I made this film, really, it was at a time when we in Britain were sort of trying to break away from our parents' view of Asian identity. You know, our parents had come to Britain. They were the original immigrants. They were very happy to put their heads down, work hard, earn their money, buy their houses, feed their families, and just get on with it. Whereas we were saying, well, hold on a minute, we don't want to be like you. We want to be part of society. If someone calls us a Paki, or if someone says, you don't belong here, we want to turn around and say, fuck you, we do. And whereas our parents would say, just get on with it.
Don't make a noise.
Don't make a noise. And so I was part of that generation trying to find that strength. And a lot of people were out there helping us. I think the Rock Against Racism movement was very, very important to me. And when bands like The Clash and Tom Robinson and people started standing up against the National Front and racism in England at that time, it was very gratifying. And very quickly, this movement developed where we started being able to define ourselves as British and Indian, or British and Black. And this was a hard-fought fight, which a lot of people can't really envisage these days, but it was post the riots as well in England. And I'm British But really came out of me wanting to explore that idea of hybridity, which was very, as you say, an original idea at the time and quite a challenging idea, and particularly using an Indian from Northern Ireland, from Scotland, from Wales, and England, all with their own accents, talking about whether they considered themselves British or not. And of course, it's so topical today.
I'm tempted to ask you, because history's moved on, and I suppose that in the moments after Rock Against Racism and the end of Thatcher, there was a kind of feeling that maybe the project of being at least the post-colonial space of a city, say in London, which was most open and well integrated in comparison with lots of what was happening in continental Europe and in other places of the world, it felt as though there was some kind of advancement and also incorporation of popular life and popular forms in all working class life, whether that was about diasporas or whether it was about white working class people in the north of England. Yeah. Now it feels as though suddenly history has kind of stopped and everyone's talking about borders, communities. We're just really talking about whether people survive refugee camps rather than whether we're talking about how people can be brought together in social life. How do you feel about living through that moment, having gone through a much more optimistic time? Whatever the struggle was, it was still a struggle which was about life in a city. It wasn't about actual crossing a border.
Well, I'm deeply grateful that I live in London, you know, and we have a brilliant mayor. and London is open. That's the quote, you know. So being part of London life means that you are part of a vibrant culture which is unifying and diverse. And so for me, you know, I'm in that bubble, you know. But I think it's very scary being out. I mean, I was in the States a few months ago before the election, and I was doing some tour, a lecture tour on the East Coast, and you see actually how divided the country is, you know, and I understand also in places in England, you know, why some people voted to opt out because of the untruths that they were being told, you know. You know, when you've got communities in places like, you know, Northumberland or Newcastle, where you've got people who have spent the last 20 years in poverty, you know, and now their children are also in poverty because they don't have the jobs, the manufacturing's gone, there's no future for their children, and then their children are having children now. You know, people are looking to blame people, and it's much easier for politicians to scapegoat people, you know, than it is to actually deal with the real business of governing people and creating jobs and creating structures where we as communities live together. Because I do believe that most people want to live together in harmony as communities. I think most people enjoy each other's cultures and vibe of things, you know, and culturally that's still there. There's still more people going to the cinema than there ever were. There's more people going to the theatre. I mean, and television is so diverse, you know. So I think on a cultural level, people like that. I just think that the way politics is at the moment is there's this easy equation that if you start picking on a group of people and start blaming them and use the race card, then you you gain popularity and you gain votes. And I don't understand this the use of the word populism, because to me populism is a leftist concept. It's about the people, it's about everybody. And so the idea of populism, you know, that's wrong. That's a minority interest.
Yeah, I want to get back to it though when we talk about the Viceroy's House, because there's the question about how you tell the story of partition to a really big cinema audience in India, as opposed to how you might tell it on sort of, you know, a really self-selected group of people watching HBO at 11 o'clock at night. Because there's a question about how what populism might mean there,
well, we
and
how,
all of that. But we should get to that. I just want to go a little bit through your career. So Gurinder makes that documentary and then immediately leaves the halls of the British Film Institute and gets on with some serious stuff and is taken up by Channel 4. Bhaji on the Beach is a really big cultural moment, a nice arrangement. What's Cooking? What I want to show is a clip from Bend It Like Beckham, which again brings me to your family story, which is always coming into what you're doing. So your family came from Kenya, and you were kind of two when they arrived in London, and your father became a postman in Southall, but then later he had a shop, right?
Yeah.
And so I'm saying that because when people see the kind of community you're dealing with, as you always say, a generation of people who are not very keen to integrate, and they're quite alarmed about it, and here you're setting up, in a way, the good girl and the bad girl, two Indian girls who are going to go in slightly different directions. In the meantime, you've got this, Perminder Nagar and Archie Punjabi, who are like, you know, the most prominent Asian actresses of their generation now, having been in that movie as well. But you're also picking on saying, well, actually, I can make an Asian movie which has got David Beckham's name in the title, and we can all talk about football because everybody likes football, right?
Well, what happened was, it was very simple. I I made Bhaji on the Beach, which a lot of people really liked. It was a cult movie. In New York, Janet Maslin gave it an amazing review in the LA Times. Someone said, you've got to see the LA Times review of your film. And I said, LA Times, is that a local paper? So I didn't really bother. And someone said, no, you've got to get the LA Times. Exactly. I thought it was like the Beckham and Penge, you know, advertiser or something. But it was a full page, front page of the calendar review of the film. A huge, glowing review, which basically said, thank God we can see other stories here. You know, that was really what the review was saying. So the film became a great hit in the East Coast, West Coast. And then I got offered various Hollywood things. And I went down that path for a bit. But it took me a long time to make a second movie. And eventually I made What's Cooking, which opened Sundance in the year 2000. But after that, I said, I want to come back home. I want to come to England. And I want to make the most commercial movie I can with an Indian girl in the lead.
So you did open at number one in the box office in the UK that year, right?
I did, yes.
I mean, for a British movie, I mean, obviously, Steven Spielberg may have beat you, but yeah.
Yeah. Actually, The Rock had a movie out that same time, and we beat The Rock to number one. We remember that. But I also, in England, you know, I was seeing things were changing. Earlier, the Union Jack, the flag, belonged to the National Front. It belonged to the right. But now what I was watching was in England football matches, you had players like Ian Wright, black players, who were running around the pitch after a match wearing the Union Jack flag. In pubs, you had black, white, Indian, whatever, people supporting England, going, England, 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 you know. And that would never have happened before. So things had changed, and I felt very strongly that football was the opposite world to where you would imagine an Indian girl to inhabit. And so if England represented football, if that was the bastion of Englishness at this point, I needed to find a way to bring me and my world into that world. And so that became Bend It Like Beckham.
Great. So let's have a clip. I've chosen a clip which is 2 or 3 minutes long, but it's you get a really strong idea of it's mum is going to see her in the park, and then we talk about it at home. So you get an idea of how maybe Gurinder is getting really big political issues out in small domestic scenes. So could we have the next clip, please? So in a way, I mean, you're building up as well, there's a television series called Goodness Gracious Me later on in the UK with people who are friends and associates of yours working on that. And there's a kind of way in which family life in the Asian communities of Britain became a part of yeah. popular culture,
yeah.
partly as a result of all the kind of thing that you were doing then.
Yes. I mean, this film came out just after 9/11. And I think it really changed race relations in Britain and in a lot of the world, because for the first time people were being able to come into the home of an Indian family, a Sikh family, and understand the world from an 18-year-old Sikh girl's perspective. And that was what the intention was, you know, was to make you feel comfortable and make you see the world from my perspective. And really, it's a very silly reason why the girl can't get what she wants. All she wants to do is play football, but her mother says she can't because it's not nice. It doesn't look nice because your sister's getting married, you know. And it's a ludicrous answer if you really stand up to it. But we know from everyone, you know, everyone knows the pressures on girls. So she accepts it because the film really was, landmark film in the sense that up until then, girls were either shown as being forced into marriages or forced into doing stuff by draconian parents. And I wanted to show that actually a lot of us have very loving parents who are strict, but they're strict for a reason. What we have to do is negotiate with them and negotiate for what we want, because it's out of their it's out of their comfort zone. It's not in their consciousness, you know. And so it was a very delicate film about negotiation for that generation. And I think so many people appreciated the fact that they could watch it with their families, and the whole family could enjoy it together. So what I had set out to do with I'm British But, I achieved with this film. And although it did take me a long time to get it financed, because you know, a lot of people didn't think that it would travel and that people would be interested in an Indian girl who wanted to play football.
And Americans always worry about football, don't they? Because it means something else.
Yeah, but then so many girls play soccer, you see. So I think the other thing is that it is overwhelmingly from a female perspective. It's a female protagonist. And I think that's also very scary for people. You know, I think, our industry really does have a problem with the lack of female storytellers. You know, we're half the audience, we're half the population. For me as a mother of a daughter, you know, I have a tremendous responsibility and a son, you know, to give them a balanced view of who they are, but also empower women. And part of the reason the film was such a success, I think, was because it was so empowering in a kind of comedic, kind of entertaining way. And I think a lot of young children, I mean, it's still really popular. I mean, just today here, after the world premiere of Viceroy's House, one of my tweets was, when are you going to make Bend It Like Beckham 2? I still get tweets every day about that. And I think it's...
No, it'd be Bend It Like Messi or something like that. because I want to show that you're not beyond using all the old-fashioned techniques to manipulate the audience's emotional state, yes. Because it is a sports movie and it's a movie about triumph against the odds, which is our theme tonight, I've picked another clip where, you know, having been somebody who's been playing Bangra music and all kinds of sounds that nobody had heard before in theatres in the UK, you go for the old-fashioned thing that fits. So this is the moment that we realise that our heroine is actually great at football. And it's the second clip from Bend It Like Beckham. I kind of wanted to play that because I like it, but also because I want to ask you about Bollywood. Because there's a way in which the Bollywood movies, which I love, have this way in which they say, look, didn't we do well? We totally manipulated you into feeling a feeling. That wasn't that great. And then if we were the sort of tight, you know, rather tight academic types that we talked about earlier in this conversation, then we go, well, no, I don't want to be manipulated in this way.
I think the thing about Bollywood is that it's very Indian, you know. It's very Indian to be emotional. There's a wonderful quote from Saroj Khan, who's a choreographer, and she actually choreographed for Pride and Prejudice. And she's doing a documentary about Bollywood, and someone asks her exactly this question about why are, you know, about Bollywood films. And she says, in India, she says, when we're happy, we sing. When we're sad, we sing. When we're crying, we sing. When someone dies, we sing. When someone's born, we sing. You know, we sing a lot. And that's the truth. In Indian culture, it's very emotional, and all the emotions are out there. And we use music and song, you know, a lot to express that. But I always resent people referring to me and my work as Bollywood, because I try very hard to make British films. What I'm doing is just opening up the definition of what British cinema is. But that's not necessarily a Bollywood moment, you know. La La Land is not a Bollywood film, but they break into song just like any Bollywood film. So it just happens that when there's Indian characters singing, people say it's Bollywood. But I think a lot of Indian people would look at La La Land and say, you know, that's a Bollywood film, but not enough dancing in it, you know, or something like that. But I think music, though, is very important to me. So you're right about that. And I think Bhangra music was very important to me because Bhangra music, which was the fusion of traditional Indian music with Western music, with pop music, with reggae music, being mixed by producers like Bali Sagu in Birmingham, Kuljeet Bamra in London, you know, and now a whole generation, Punjabi MC had a worldwide hit with his track that Jay-Z sampled. That music to me really is music to my soul because that music has been able to hybridize our identity and you know, in a way that I've been trying to do with film. And there is a whole British music industry that has now actually been exported to India. And a lot of British music producers, Indian music producers, are actually working in India because we've changed Indian music because of the way we did it in Britain. So you'll find now that a lot of Bollywood films have kind of those Western beats and fusion and rapping and all the rest of it.
It's interesting you talk about extending the boundaries of British cinema. Well, I mean, I don't know what the boundaries are, but that there's a way in which, when I look at your work and I look at the characters, I particularly look at the representation of the upper-class characters who are in Viceroy's House, and I think that in a way, having been a subject of a British colonial system, I mean, in terms of your family in Kenya, and the way in which you'd have the colonial administration system that North Asians would be sent to Africa to public official jobs and all those kind of things. There's an Edwardian Raj sense in which your sense of England is much more English than English people is, in a sense. Do you ever feel that your idea of Indian of British heritage is in a way much more complex than people who are who've just been living in England and don't know what it's all about?
Well, I mean, my memories are of the same TV programs, of the same pop songs, of, you know, of a lot of people growing up in England. You know, the influence, you know, when David Bowie came on the scene, you know, being slightly freaked out by that because I didn't understand what homosexuality was. You know, but so much about popular culture, you know, British popular culture is me, is part of me. So it finds its way in my work. But at the same time, I've grown up with the same British Raj movies as everyone else. Jewel in the Crown, of course, was a seminal series for TV. Gandhi, A Passage to India. These are part of my kind of cultural heritage as much as anything else. And so for me, for Viceroy's House, it was very simple, the idea of making this a British Raj movie. It made sense because it was 1947, and I wanted to make a film that talked about the role of the British Raj in partition. But I also wanted to talk about the effects of those decisions on ordinary people. So hence the upstairs, downstairs. So here I was able to talk about the British upstairs and then the impact of their decisions on the servants downstairs. So for me, it kind of worked as a conceit. Also, as a British film, I didn't have a huge budget, but I did want to try and make something epic. And so setting it all in the house and using the house as a microcosm for the rest of India, you know, helped in terms of my budget, but also allowing me to go epic, you know, when I could.
But there's now a kind of hybrid form, and there are a number of films where, in a way, there's there, you know, because in Hindi there's a word for a film with no songs, but there's no word for a musical because, or at least that's the way people talk it, the Bombay talkie has got to have at least eight songs. Mm. And then when you do
Bride and Prejudice.
Bride and Prejudice. You move towards the idea of a Bollywood musical, but you're more in that form, which is now becoming popular, where there are Indian producers and financiers from Mumbai who are saying, all right, let's make a film in Europe or America which will have a popular appeal in India, potentially, but won't be a singing movie, but will be very Indian.
Yeah.
Do you feel part of a movement? Because there are a number of people doing that kind of work.
Yeah, I think there are a lot of very interesting filmmakers of Indian origin, some in India, some without, who are making films that have perhaps an Indian dimension, which play in India, you know, and play abroad. And for a long time, there was basically myself, Amir and Air, that did that, and Deepa Mehta, you know. So now, you know, India is a very interesting place, you know. Before, if you wanted to make a film in India, you had to really think about the singing and the dancing. If you wanted to make a really big film, or you were making a small sort of art house movie, you know. But now I think you can make quite a big movie in India with totally a Western sensibility, but cast it with Indians from India and make it appeal to the Indian view of the world, you know. And that's where things become a bit tricky, you know, because, you know, there aren't many people who are out there making films that consciously try to appeal to different constituents in the way that I do. I mean, it's important for me that, you know, when I make a film, you know, it's important for me that people, you know, I make it for people to watch, you know. I'm not making it for myself to sit in a room and watch the video and go, didn't I do a good job, you know. I make it so that as many people as possible watch it and their minds are changed by what I'm saying. You know, I want to influence people's minds. I want to influence their ideas of what it means to see the world from my point of view. You know, I want people to see films with people who are normally on the margins of society in the center of the frame. And it's a hard thing to do because who is it that I'm making the film for, you know? And initially, I always say it's for people like me, you know? And people like me, what does that mean? So people like me is people who have grown up in cities that are incredibly diverse, that know people of different backgrounds and understand the cultural processes of being, having a kind of dual identity of being European and also Indian, or being Chinese and also American, you know, or being German and also Turkish, or, you know, it's those dualities that culturally I speak to, and there are very few filmmakers that actually do that on a populist level. Having said that, beyond that, then, you know, obviously I want English people to enjoy the film, you know, and then I also want Indians in India to enjoy the film. But then to make a film like Viceroy's House that's going to appeal to someone living in a small town in India whose family went through partition, you know, compared to somebody who lives in the London suburbs whose parents perhaps were colonials in British Raj India, you know, making a film that will appeal to both sides is kind of where I really have my work cut out for me, because I want them both, you know.
Well, also, in relation to the sort of populist side, in a way you have to take a position. You take a position, your version of partition is in a way about is a version of partition, which is about the betrayal of the secularist movement and of Nehru's, you know, attempt and Gandhi's advice to hold India together as a great democratic nation based on secularism. And so Jinnah comes out pretty bad out of the wash. He doesn't seem to be a particularly good guy.
But
you presumably want to distribute that film in Pakistan too.
I don't think Jinnah does come out of it like that. I worked hard at making sure that I was fair to Jinnah in a way that Gandhi didn't.
Maybe I was just—I had my own opinion and I didn't watch your film. Sorry.
It would have been very easy for me to make a film that casts the white colonials as the bad guys, you know, who came in and look what they did to us. It would have been easy for me to make a film that made Jinnah look like a villain for, you know, making a pact with Churchill, which led to the division of India, you know. That would have made Indians happy, but it would have made Pakistanis really unhappy. I could have villainized Nehru, you know, because he accepted partition, you know, when Gandhi was saying, hold out, hold out. They won't cut the country if you don't accept it, you know. So there, when one goes back and looks at history, the history that I was taught was very prejudicial, you know, on India. It was very much the European version of what happened. We gave them the railways.
But the interesting thing here is that your alternative history is sort of the Mountbatten story rather than the story from Downing Street. Or it comes from a different kind of establishment source, right?
It is a different so I grew up being taught at school that partition happened because we started fighting with each other. It was our fault. Mountbatten had come to India to hand India back. But because we started fighting with each other and we started writing, Mountbatten had no option but to divide the country. And so really, partition was our fault. The evidence, of course, now is to the contrary. What I was taught at school was wrong, was lies. Of course, to run an empire, you have to have a certain amount of hegemony on, you know, the ideas you put out there. And so as a schoolgirl, for me, that was the narrative of partition. Whereas my mum, who grew up in Rawalpindi, would say at school, I had Muslim friends, Hindu friends, Sikh friends, we all lived together, we all played together. When there were Muslim festivals of Eid, we celebrated with them. When we had our festivals of Diwali or Gurpurab, they celebrated with us. She said, everybody got on fine, then all of a sudden, something happened. She said, I don't know what happened, but I think the English did some kind of black magic and put something in the water and everything changed. So this is what my 90-year-old mother still says, you know. So those were the two narratives that I grew up with.
This is why you say history belongs to the victors in the beginning of the film.
Yeah, so I think with Viceroy's House, what I wanted to do was try and tell a different version of a very tumultuous period in time. Rather than blame, okay, I wanted to treat each person involved in a very human way, put their points forward, look at their arguments, see how they were all culpable to some degree of what happened to my family. But ultimately, I also wanted to debunk the myth that Mountbatten was to blame, because I wanted to show that actually he was the plant, he was the fall guy for a much bigger plan that was going on behind the scenes. And it was really the beginning of what we now call fake news, you know. The British had a plan to divide the country. It was orchestrated. Partition was not, as I had been told, a reaction to what was going on. It was a political act. It was a geopolitical act where superpowers like America and Britain were looking at the post-war map of the world in 1945 and going, what the hell are we going to do with Stalin? He's taking over Asia. And if we hand India back, what's going to happen to us? And so they made a plan to partition the country. So I wanted to make a film where people, if people came out going, oh, they were to blame, oh, they were to blame, oh, that's the villain, that's the villain, I think it would be too easy. I think now you have to come out and you have to really think what the hell happened, and hopefully you make connections with how that is happening again today. Very much what happened 70 years ago is happening exactly the same way today. And if I had made it about one faction versus another and villainized one and then another, I think it would have been a much smaller film. I think by doing what I've done, I think hopefully I've made it a much bigger film.
I hope so. It'll be very interesting
to
see.
I hope so too, but you never know.
Because in a way, I'm saying this in admiration, because it is the ultimate tightrope walk, because in a way, also the way you talk about politics and the way that the characters talk about ideas and the way you represent romance and so on in lots of ways is very Indian as opposed to very Western.
Well, I think then
the audience has to sort of bounce between those two.
Yeah, and I think that ultimately will be the challenge of the film, because I think that, you know, some Western people will probably want more of the upstairs and more politics, and a lot of Indians will probably want more of the Indian characters and the downstairs, and some people will write about the film who don't care about the Indian characters because they don't think they're as important as the ones upstairs. Whereas from where I'm sitting, I started making the film because I cared about the people downstairs, and I wanted to see what the impact of those geopolitical decisions were going to be on ordinary people and ordinary people's lives. So that's the kind of emotional heart of the film. And, you know, people are not used to seeing films that blend different cultures in that way. So I think it will be very easy for some people to dismiss it. But what do I do? Do I kowtow and make a completely a British film, or do I make a completely Indian film? You know, I can't. I have to make a film that's true to who I am, which is seeing both. And soon there will be more people like me making films, so we'll have those dualities. I'm waiting for those Turkish German filmmakers who will be making, you know, German films, but from that fused point of view.
They're out there. There's a wonderful popular comedy called Alemania, which is absolutely
fantastic.
In this vein, which I should send you a DVD of it.
And they do it in France as well now.
Mm. I want to ask you about arriving at this big production. I mean, in a way, you were in Hollywood again. I mean, we haven't done your whole history because, of course, there's After Bendit, there's 4 or 5 features and a British television series and all kinds of other things happening. But there was a moment there where your name was connected with a very famous American television series that film wasn't made. But you were thinking, okay, let's do the Hollywood thing for a while.
Yeah.
And then maybe you had a family, so maybe it wasn't such a great moment. And then we got you back in Europe.
Yeah.
But here you are in this film, even if it's not the hugest budget, you're working with a huge cast, with a fantastically big crew, and so on. How did it feel to move up to that kind of stage from quite domestic work into stuff which is of that scale?
Yeah, it was fantastic. It was absolutely fantastic to be able to really plot and storyboard a film with epic ambitions, you know, and epic not just visually, also in terms of the emotions and the story that was being told, you know. Most people in the world do not know about the partition of India. Most people will not know about this history. This film will tell you about a very important period that has defined who I am. And to me, that's epic, you know.
Yeah.
People might not care, you know, about India or Pakistan, but it is a history that was hidden, that I have now shined a massive big light on. And I think that is what I'm grateful for, was the chance to be able to tell that story, tell that history at a time when, you know, we have refugee problems everywhere and we're all trying to deal with that, and we're trying to deal with the politics of hate and where that will eventually lead us to. So in that sense, I think the film is very timely and feels very modern.
Yeah. I want to throw it out to there's people, whether they've seen this at the Vice's house, or they want to ask Gurinder anything else. I think there's some people with microphones around, yes, in 2 corners of the room. Does anyone, there's a question there in the second row.
First of all, thank you very much for your film. I feel very blessed that I could be at the world premiere yesterday.
Oh, thank you.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
They say they, I have a two-part question. I apologize, I try to keep it as short as I can because I know people want to hear you talk, not me. So first, they say there are three films, the ones you write, the one you shoot, and the one that actually you have when you're finished in the editing room. So with all these compromises between the different audience you try to be appealing to and everything, can you talk something about your first vision and the result and how these are related, how much compromises you had to do? The second thing is, I'm a filmmaker myself. I went to Munich Film School, but I did documentaries that also were screened on film festivals. And my wife is from Southall. Beaconsfield Road.
Oh, my goodness.
So she's there right now. I was just texting her that I'm here with you.
Wow.
And right now, my question takes me a lot of courage, and it's going to be against all odds because I'm working on my first fictional long feature, and it's going to be a story about two women in India. And I'm not a woman. I'm not from India. I've never been to India, actually, but I'm trying to develop a story. So what do I have to do to get a few minutes with you and ask you for advice?
That's the question that we don't actually allow that question, but never mind. But you can certainly answer about the three stages of disillusion.
Well, do you know, funnily enough, I have to say that Viceroy's House is the film we set out to make. It's very close to the script. The only deviation I would say is that during the editing process, we took a bit of time editing because we explored different balances. We had to find the balance. What were we comfortable with? Sometimes were we too much on the history side and not enough love story? Other times were we too much love story and not enough on this side? So I think, if anything, that we have the luxury in the editing room of the time to find the balance. And I was very much supported by my editor, Valerio, who's Italian, and very emotional. So Valerio cried all the time throughout the whole editing process. And I was sort of like, okay, come on, can we get back to cutting now, you know? And very sweet, lovely man, you know, very passionate. And I think that and then also my lovely friend, actually, and producer, Cameron McCracken from Pathé, is very English, you know, it's kind of the opposite of Valerio. And so between the two, we had a very English perspective, we had an Italian perspective, we had my perspective. And so we kind of juggled to find the right balance. And I think I'm very happy that in the end we've ended up with a balance that I think is correct. In terms of advice, do your research, watch lots of films, and do lots of background, and be informed. Don't make judgments without being informed about women in India.
All right, another one. There's someone in the front row. I'll get some more in the back, Zara. We'll get to you.
Hello. I'm a filmmaker from Pakistan, from Lahore, Punjab. I'm a Punjabi. So last time I went to London, I just went to Southall. I'm coming from Southall. So every time I visit, so I have good experience of Southall. So my question is, when you make a film on an Indian or Pakistani subject, be it Deepa Mehta or Meera Nair, Water and Slum Bombay, and East is East, when you go to those countries and make films in these locations with these characters, why the language is English? I know it's because to cater the international market, but today in this modern era when people are very mature with cinema, they don't understand this thing that the characters, he is just a layman and speaking English. Mm. So this is my concern, actually, as a filmmaker. Mm.
Yeah, I think you're quite right. I think that that's the power of Western cinema, you know. And I think that there is this belief that audiences, you know, don't want to read subtitles. You know, they want to everything in English. I think in Bend It Like Beckham, for example, it was important for me to have a lot of Punjabi. I actually had a lot of Punjabi in that film, even though, you know, it's set in London, because I felt the characters would speak like that, and the mother uses a lot of Punjabi swear words, you know, throughout, which give authenticity.
Which are not picked up by Channel 4, they just let them go.
Right? Yeah, exactly. But I think that, but I felt at that point, people didn't need to know what she was saying, they just needed to know that she was mad, you know, and angry and using swear words, you know. But if you were Indian and you got them, then they were very funny, you know. But I think that it's a very valid point, and I think that sadly, you know, the way the world cinema operates, you know, English is the language, you know. So it's...
But in the Indian version of the Viceroy's House, the characters will speak in Hindi and Urdu and stuff, will they? Or?
Well, the Reliance is releasing the film in India and it's been dubbed in Hindi. So actually the English characters will be speaking in Hindi.
Oh, good.
Yeah.
So I'd like to see Lord Mountbatten is going to speak Hindi.
Yes, in a very English accent. Hum, hum einge, hum kam karenge, aapke saath, like that.
Great. I hope Hugh Bonneville's going to do the job himself from a from a short course.
I think we will get to that point. We're not there yet, but we will get there soon. We will get there soon.
Yeah.
And in Pride and Prejudice, actually, I did do some songs in Hindi as well. I did the opening song, Bale Bale. I did that in Punjabi on purpose, so that the first song was a full-on Punjabi Bollywood song. And the way I got around the language was, after each verse, I had... one of the characters translate it for Darcy in a funny way, you know. And so I have tried to find inventive ways of doing it. But I think that, you know, for foreign sales, I think people are lazy. I think people want things to be in English.
Yeah. You've still got a question? You haven't got a microphone, though. Can we have a microphone down here in the second row, please?
Hello, Gurinder. I used to live in London until recently, and I've seen a BBC series, Indian Summer. Ah. Were you involved in any way?
No.
Do you have an opinion on that?
Yes, but not that I should share publicly.
Oh, right.
It's okay. It's only just being blogged everywhere in the world.
I know.
Yeah. Would you pass the microphone forward? Yeah. Sorry.
There you go. Hi. I was there yesterday. I think I said hi to you yesterday. I think you were really effective in showing the other side of history. My grandfather, there's another round of Indians that left India. You know, they saw a ship and they sailed, and my grandfather moved to Malaysia. And I think a lot of Indians moved even during that time. And I could really sense the that side of history that I heard. It was not just, the British saving the land and giving government. And I saw the side, I learned about divide and conquer. And they did the same thing in Malaysia. Indians have 10% of everything. And then the natives have 70%. So even moving to Malaysia, and then I moved to the States. So it was, you know, just this dual consciousness. You show that effectively in your films, dual consciousness and the struggle of the immigrant, even though you are born and raised, and first generation Indians that hold on to that culture.
I think it's important to say that what I try and do is not problematize it. I think for other people it's a problem. For me it's never a problem. You know, if you are bilingual, it's a joy to be bilingual. If you're not bilingual, you don't know what you're missing, you know. The fact that I can speak Punjabi is a massive, massive asset for me, because I have a window into an ancient culture, music, you know, language, cinema, literature, all kinds of stuff, because I know that language. Sorry. So I think it's important to say that this dualism when we're in charge of expressing it, that we do it in a positive way, in a celebratory way, because there are many people who would want to problematize it. Excuse me.
Right. Yep. You need one of those sweets. Let's talk a bit while Gurinder has a glass of water. She's been giving interviews for 48 hours non-stop, so you understand. Yeah. There's a question there. Where are you? We can see you, but you don't have a microphone, but you could shout and I'll repeat. There is a massive spoiler on this film because it's a film of global historical stories, but there is something that directly affects Gurinder, like in every one of her films, in a sense of that.
I won't spoil the
evolves,
ending.
But we shouldn't spoil
Pretend
it because lots of people
hear
haven't
that.
Seen
Anybody
it.
Hasn't seen
Pretend
it,
you though. Didn't hear anything about that.
I think that it was important for me to. Once I'd made a film of this terrible event in history, it was important for me to end on some hope, you know. Not necessarily a happy ending, but definitely a hopeful one. Oh my God, I don't know what's happened to my bloody throat.
It's all right, we'll talk more.
So I think that,
I tell
Again,
you what, I
that's
could...
the balance. Some people would say leave it in a very sad, depressing place. And that's also a very valid point, you know. But I chose the ending I did because it was partly based on the truth of what happened in my own family, which you learn about later. So that's why I ended up making that decision. And I don't know, it's just me. I always want you to come out of my films feeling that, you know, I tell you terrible things, stories about racism and prejudice and here rioting and terrible historical, shameful periods. But I still believe that I want people to come out feeling more connected as human beings and that there's more that connects us than divides us. And I feel that, you know, when I make a film, I feel that I want people to come out with that message at the end of the day. You know, that there's more that connects us than divides us. And let's learn somehow from what we've seen.
So I have a proposal to make. We have a few more minutes together. One thing I want to do is I want to get Paul Burgess, who is the co-writer of this movie, but also coincidentally the father of your twins and your partner in life.
Yes.
You don't need to speak. Oh, I'm just trying because people are very curious about how that works when you write scripts together and do all those other things too, but maybe if you don't want to, we'll... Yeah. Okay, well, you know, so I want you to give some... A few last words, if you can get some out, really, because there's a lot of filmmakers here who are thinking about, okay, should I be sophisticated and deal with the reality of the world and modernity, or should I be a populist? You're here to tell them that actually there's no need to make this choice at all, and what should they do next to try and be uncompromising about getting a bigger audience and going out there and making a bigger movement for films about women and black people and people who are not at the center of Hollywood and of mainstream cinema?
Blimmin' hell, that's a Sorry. Big question.
Just a few
I
words, if you don't
I think the most
mind.
Important thing as a filmmaker is well, actually, it's two things. I think the first thing is that you've got to know why you want to be a filmmaker. Why are you doing this? Why do you want to tell stories? Be very clear about that, because that then will drive you when you need inspiration to deal with all the knocks. The second thing is, who are you making films for? Who is it that you want to talk to? You know, so these are the two things you have to ask yourself as a filmmaker. And then you will end up making the films for the answers of those two questions. And, you know, there's nothing wrong in making a small film for yourself, for, you know, an intellectual group that pushes certain ideas. There's nothing wrong with that. I think that's commendable. You know, I think that, you know, making a massive, huge film, I know, like Paddington, you know, is great because...
Paddington's a great film about racism in London.
Exactly.
But I'm going to stop you,
though. That was my point.
But
it's about racism in London,
I'm going to stop you because
yeah.
You have to go to Tegel, and you've already told them the two things they should do, and Paul needs to go to the airport. So
okay.
Is that all right? Can I do
Thank
that?
Thank you very much,
Those
everyone.
Were Gurinder's last words in a great
Thank
tour
you.
Of Berlin. Thank you so much. Thank you.
That was really good. We should do that again. Yeah. We should do that in London sometime. Yeah.